Berks Business on BCTV is supported by the Berks Career and Technology Center.
Hello and welcome to Berks Business. I'm Bob Wert, Managing Director of Investments of the Wert Investment Consulting Group of Wells Fargo Advisors. Each month on Berks Business, we give you the opportunity to meet the leaders of our regional business community. And tonight we're bringing you Lauren Tobiassen, who is the Area President for Wells Fargo Bank. Lauren, welcome to the program.
Thank you very much for having me, Bob.
Glad you could be here. Tell us a little bit about how Wells Fargo came to be in Berks County.
Well, Wells Fargo has actually been in Berks County for 125 years through one of our direct predecessor banks, Schuylkill Valley.
Right.
But an interesting fact is we've actually been involved in this area since the 1850s.
Most people wouldn't know that.
Yeah. We had advertised a product which was a bill of exchange that would enable people in East Coast cities, Reading being one of them, to have funds available right away.
So Reading was at one point had the home of the Reading Railroad, which is the largest industrial company in the world. When you look on the monopoly board, you'll see the Reading Railroad. And Wells Fargo has a little bit of experience with mining.
Yes.
And the folks out in San Francisco, so there was some connection there as well.
Well, there definitely was. When we had miners who came from this area and went to the West in search of gold,
right.
Wells Fargo enabled them to be able to send money back to their families here.
Exactly. So talk about how you came to be here.
Well, I have been with Wells Fargo for, it'll be 27 years in May. I started in our headquarters state in California.
Right.
I've had an opportunity to work in a couple of different states and have been here for a few years. I've also had the opportunity to move all over in the bank. I've done pretty much everything. I've worked in our phone bank, small business lending, marketing, but my true love is our retail stores because of the interaction with the customers.
And it's interesting, you call them retail stores. I mean, most of the time when you think about banks, you say, oh, bank branches. What's the nuance of calling it a store?
You know, we just view it, and I think it goes back to our vision and values, viewing it as kind of a community gathering place where we are, you know, really helping people not only with their everyday needs that they may come in for, but also with kind of a plan for the future.
Right.
And so as far back as I can remember, we've referred to them as stores.
Okay. And just talk about a little bit how you got prepared educationally for this career.
I actually have a degree in economics and a degree in communications, and then I have an MBA in marketing, and which has really helped a lot with kind of understanding our business, but also understanding people and being able to help people. I've had opportunities in the bank to work in the marketing area, which has been wonderful as well.
So talk about economics and how that fits into what you do and communications. I mean, those are such disparate fields.
Well, definitely. Well, growing up with a father who was an economics professor, that was kind of a given choice for a major. But right. I also added on the communications because I knew whatever position I landed in, I needed to be able to collaborate with other people to build relationships. And so it's really worked out well. The economics gives kind of a foundation for, you know, understanding what's going on in the country and how that impacts our customers and how we can best help them. And then the communications piece, I think, you know, is useful anywhere.
It's kind of essential, yeah.
Yeah.
So did you go straight to grad school or did you take some time off?
I took a couple years off and worked in retail as a manager and as a buyer.
Okay.
And then I went back to school from there, and I actually, our former CEO at the time had gone to University of Southern California where I got my MBA and came and talked about the bank and the culture of the company and convinced me to try a summer internship, and I've been here ever since.
Ah, so summer intern turned to permanent career.
Yep.
Okay, so for the interns out there, this is something to be aware of.
Absolutely.
Okay, let's talk about your current responsibilities. What is it you do today?
Currently, I'm an area president, and I have 53 stores covering a pretty wide geography. I have 18 here in Berks County, but I also go out into York, Harrisburg, Lancaster, Lebanon. So I spend a lot of time in my car.
I would think so.
Yes.
So in addition to the stores, do you have other responsibilities as well?
Well, I'm responsible for a lot of partnering with our business banking group. I do a lot of business lending. I partner very closely with our mortgage group. We do, obviously, a lot of mortgage lending. And I'm responsible for everything from the day-to-day running of the stores, staffing, education of our team members. I am involved with our foundation, giving out grants. Everything from just the other day, I was with our corporate properties group driving around looking for new locations that would be beneficial for customers.
So what are the principal lines of business? What does the company actually do?
Well, I think probably most people know Wells Fargo as a traditional retail bank.
Right.
You know, we take in deposits, we give out loans, but we do a lot more. We are very involved in small business. We have been the number one small business lender in the United States for the past 14 years. And I think that's really important. We are very invested in helping businesses be successful, whether it's starting up a business. And we have so many resources available on our website. Just one of the many things that we have to support people is we have help with building a business plan. And these are things not just for current Wells Fargo customers, but for any business owner who's interested. So business is very important. We also have a big investment arm, a big mortgage lending. And we really can help customers with anything that they need, from insurance to, you know, credit cards.
And is that just for businesses or individuals or not-for-profits? What kind of term are
all of the above?
Okay.
And we have a big emphasis also on our high school students, college students. We do a lot with our military.
Okay.
We really want to educate people to help them. I mean, in our vision and values, it talks about helping our customers succeed financially.
Right.
We want everyone to have a plan, not just for what they need today, but for that goal that they want to reach in the future.
Exactly. So the whole idea being what? Articulate what the goal is, look at where you are today, and figure out how to get from A to B?
Pretty much. And have a banker who you have a relationship with, somebody who is going to be there with you, someone who is going to educate, but also, you know, work for you and help you with the steps that you need to meet that goal.
So what, if you were a small or a business owner in general, what advice would you get in how to partner? If you say to somebody, what kind of questions should I ask my banker? What kind of resources are available? Sometimes people don't even know what questions to ask.
Yeah, and I think, you know, we have a lot of bankers who specialize in business. They've been given additional training. They have a network of partners in business who can help. And so I think it would be just going into one of the stores and asking for the business specialist, asking for the store manager who can really sit down with the business owner. And I think it really comes down to, you know, cash flow, having enough cash to do business every day.
Right.
How am I going to expand my business? How to establish credit in the name of the business, not just using your individual personal credit. And even things like paying your employees and how to accept payments from customers. You know, there's so many ways technologically now to accept payments, and you can expand your customer base by accepting or giving more choices to your customers.
Makes good sense. So what would you like people to know about the company?
Well, I think that if anyone wants to know about Wells Fargo, the best thing to do is look at our vision and values. We have a booklet which we have had for years, and it's available on wellsfargo.com.
Right.
And our vision and values talks about the culture of the company, what values are important to us. You know, things like ethics and diversity and inclusion, leadership, doing what's right for our customers.
Right.
And the vision and values is a booklet that every new team member is given when they start with the bank. And we really use it as kind of a guidebook. I have one in my car, one in my briefcase, one in my desk, and anytime I'm making an important decision, I always refer to the vision and values.
So it's nice to know that people are on the same page.
Absolutely.
Okay.
And I think another thing, excuse me, that's important is our philanthropy. Wells Fargo is not the biggest company out there in the U.S., but we are one of the biggest corporate givers, usually at the top or near the top of the list, and we do a lot in giving back to our communities. Excuse me.
Anything in Berks?
In Berks, definitely. In 2014, we gave $262 million in Berks.
$260,000 in Berks and
$1,000, yes. And
allergies.
I understand.
Dry weather. $262,000.
And then in 2015, I know that number was much higher.
Yeah.
I am so sorry. It's the dry weather.
Oh, I understand that. So let's talk, I mean, that's the slide, so we'll take a moment and let's take a look at some of the graphics. You can tell us what we're looking at.
Oh, perfect.
So, got the logo there. And so now, what are we looking
Thank
at?
You. So what this
is our signature day of giving.
Much better.
There we go.
So, we have an event every year where we have anywhere between 100 and 2,550 Wells Fargo team members and their families who come out and volunteer. We partner with a nonprofit in the area. These photos are from our event last year, which was partnering with the Olivet Boys and Girls Club here in Reading.
Right.
We built a playground. We revitalized their whole area near their swimming pool. We did landscaping, painting. It's a great event because not only do our team members come out, but their families, actually in this picture, the tall boy in the background is my son. It's just really a great day. So we try to have something like that
every
single year.
Tell us about Jack the dog.
Jack the dog actually is a real dog from Wells Fargo's history. If you go to our history museum or look in the books, mm-hmm. and he's really someone that we bring out to events like this. Kids absolutely love Jack the dog. And he's featured prominently in a lot of the Wells Fargo history.
So Jack was an actual dog that rode on a stagecoach.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's kind of an interesting tie into the whole motif. What are we looking at here?
So this is the same event. Again, we kind of re-landscape the whole area. We partner with local businesses to help us with the plants, help us with the playground equipment, and we come and do all the work over a several hour period, and then we invite all the families in the community to come in and enjoy music, food, and a formal ribbon cutting.
Speaking of which,
yeah.
So tell us about the ribbon cutting. I see you're holding a big check there too.
Absolutely. So we presented a check for about $70,000 to the Olivet Boys and Girls Club. And you can see the playground in the background.
Right.
This is when all the work is done. We have all the families and children there that you can't see in the picture waiting. Actually, this was the formal opening of the pool. So as we cut that ribbon, all of the kids were running,
jumping in
the pool. It was a hot day. And really enjoying the new playground and pool area.
And this is all in Reading?
That was all in Reading, yep.
Sweet. Okay. Now what are we looking at?
So this is one of many check presentations that we did last year. And basically where we have our team members who are involved in local organizations being able to present a check to them from our foundation. And we also have Nellie, one of our ponies every year, Wells Fargo introduces a new pony. We have the big ponies like this one that we actually just finished donating to local schools.
Oh, cool.
And this is another check presentation. Similar, we probably do, I would say, about at least 50 to 75 mm-hmm. every single year.
Yeah, I think that's a good way of connecting with the community. And get not just the money part, but just the idea of showcasing philanthropy and encouraging other people to do the same.
Absolutely.
So let's talk about the Wells Fargo Foundation, because I know a little something about that.
Yep.
But what's the scope in terms of the size, and what are the kind of organizations that it supports?
Well, the Wells Fargo Foundation, again, we're one of the biggest corporate givers in the United States. We support all sorts of organizations. We have a strong emphasis on K-12 education. Mm-hmm. We do a lot of support for low-income communities,
right.
A lot of support for housing, and also we do a lot for the arts. So many different organizations are impacted by our foundation. We meet every quarter, and we really try to make sure that we're able to help a wide variety of organizations who really are going to benefit the community.
So it's everything from the Reading Symphony to the Literacy Council.
Mm-hmm. Museum.
The museum, yep. BCTV,
things like that. Absolutely, yes.
So I got the pleasure of bringing a big check here once.
Yeah.
Which is very helpful. Let's change the topic a little bit and talk about technology. I mean, people think, well, big old stodgy bank. Does a big old stodgy bank use technology?
No, absolutely. In fact, one of the pride points of Wells Fargo is how technologically advanced we are. Mm-hmm. One of the things that I learned in my time in working in marketing is that we're constantly asking our customers what's important to them. I can't tell you how many focus groups I did, how many times we reached out, and with technology, that's what we're doing. We're listening to our customers. How do they want to bank? What's convenient for them? You know, what are they interested in? One of the things that we've had feedback on recently is, you know, people want to be able to use an ATM or access their money without having to have a card with them,
okay.
Maybe using their smartphone.
Right.
And so we have some really interesting, you know, advances coming out in the very near future that will enable people to do just that.
Hmm.
So I would say, in terms of technology, we're just always asking and listening and always looking for better ways to make it more convenient
right.
for people to do their banking.
That's just interesting, just being able to use a smartphone to deposit a check.
Yeah.
And that's people like, I think, to be able to, 2 o'clock in the morning, if you want to deposit a check, you can.
Absolutely.
And
yes.
One thing that's interesting, too, is if you're on Pacific time and when the checks are processed, you can deposit a check up to... Was it 6 p.m. here, and mm-hmm. it's 9 p.m. there?
Yeah.
So,
yeah,
it gives you a little extra advantage in that way.
Absolutely.
So how do you balance the desire to meet face-to-face versus the use of technology, and is there, what kind of mix do you look to achieve?
You know, it's interesting that you mentioned that, because I constantly am asked, you know, when do you think retail stores will go away?
Right.
And I always answer the same thing. I don't think they will, because as technologically advanced as we become, we always have a base of customers who want that human interaction, who want to be able to walk into a brick and mortar building,
right.
talk to their banker who they have had a relationship with for years, you know, their teller who knows them.
Mm-hmm.
I have tellers in my stores who have not only known their customers, but their children, their grandchildren.
Right.
And I don't think the appeal of that is ever going to go away. So I think the nice thing about Wells Fargo is having that balance. If you want the human contact, we're here for you.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to be able to do everything on your smartphone, we can make that happen as well.
And sometimes it's not either or, it can be and both.
Absolutely.
So how do you see banking evolving going forward?
You know, I think we're going to have to continue, all of us, to listen to what our customers want, to be able to make things safer, more convenient, you know, easier. And so I would see those technological advances, you know, continuing.
Mm-hmm.
I know, you know, we have a whole group in the bank that's just constantly looking at that. And I also think that we're looking at, for the face-to-face contact in the stores, you know, how do we make it more convenient? I'm always looking at different locations. We
right.
recently expanded our hours in a lot of our stores based on actually looking at ATM transactions.
Right.
So if we had a lot of people using the ATM after hours, we looked at expanding our hours so we could be open during the times that most people were coming to the ATM.
So how does that work out? Do a lot of people decide to come into the store instead?
They do. Absolutely.
And is it better that they do that? That gives you an opportunity to talk about other things?
Well, we love our customers to come in all the time.
Sure.
And we just want to be there when they need us to be there. So
okay.
if they would like us to be there on Saturdays, we expanded Saturday hours in some locations. And so, yes, we'd love for them to be able to use the ATM or use the drive.
Right.
But it's also great to be able to come in.
So on one hand, you're always looking to have more convenience and more interaction. On the other hand, there's the need for security. And we're in an environment where cybersecurity and everything else is a very big deal.
Absolutely.
So how do you balance the need for safety and security versus accessibility and friendliness?
You know, I think it's interesting because some of the products we have, such as our bill pay product,
Right.
Which I can't even imagine living without. It enables you to save money, save time, but it also is more secure. It gives you more control. So I think we have so many different things that, you know, we have things that you can, you know, look at your credit, protect your identity, so many things that are advances that also enable you to have a peace of mind and make sure that everything is absolutely fine with all of your funds.
Well, actually, that's probably a good topic. We only have about 2 or 3 minutes left to talk about the how do you protect your credit and how do you know where you stand?
And I think that's very important. Everyone should know what their credit score is. In fact, we have several times during the year when we give free credit scores or have access for our customers without having to pay for it. Hmm. It's very important to know what your score is and also what you can do if you want to move it.
Right.
That's one of the many reasons we have people come in and talk to a banker, is really sitting down and saying, if my credit isn't where I want it to be, or if I'm trying to rebuild or build it the first time, what do I do? And what's my plan to be able to do that?
So what are some basic tips on how to work with the bank and how to get the credit score to go up?
Well, I think understanding, you know, things that impact it, different types of credit, how an auto loan impacts it compared to a credit card. Is it better to pay off your credit card in full every month, or do you leave a balance?
Right. Well, actually, yeah, I think that'd be good for our viewers to know.
Yeah, yeah. And, I mean, we want to improve your credit score, you want to use credit. We want, and you want to have a variety of credit. I know I have a daughter who's about to graduate from college, and we got her her first credit card, and now I'm talking to her about, you need to get an installment loan on your credit. Let's look at getting an auto loan so you can build your credit up. So by the time you're ready to want to buy your first home, you have a high credit score because you've used a variety of different credit vehicles. So having a plan like that, you know, with your banker and being able to watch your credit score move, I think is very satisfying for people.
So knowing what question to ask when, or having a banker who can draw those questions out and provide guidance is a major part of why people would still want to come into a store.
Absolutely. I think it's having that starting point of knowing what your credit score is, and then working with your banker on a plan of how to get the score to where you want it to be.
In an age where everything is electronic and people are concerned maybe about identity theft and that sort of thing, what happens in the event that identity is compromised? Is there a way, does the bank stand behind people, or how does that work?
Absolutely. The bank has, I mean, through our credit vehicles, so many different ways that they really do stand behind you. And I can't tell you how many examples I have of where we've had someone absolutely panicked because someone took over their identity, they were using their funds, and we were able to make it right for them and then give them some suggestions for things they could do to make sure that doesn't happen to them again going forward. Unfortunately, there's a lot of that out there, but there are different things that people can do to protect themselves.
Exactly. So that's something they can get when they have their conversation?
Yes, definitely.
Okay, very good. Well, Lauren, I'd like to thank you for being on the program. Our guest has been Lauren Tobiassen, who is the area president for Wells Fargo. I'm Bob Wert, Managing Director Investments of the Wert Investment Consulting Group of Wells Fargo Advisors. Each month on Berks Business, we give you the opportunity to meet the leaders of our regional business community. We'd like to thank you for joining us, and we'll see you again the second Monday of next month.
Berks Business on BCTV is supported by Berks Career and Technology Center.